So you've been working on a multiplayer game, and it's great. But now you try it with a friend, and it's terribly laggy. You see, networking isn't about pushing data over a socket. That's the easy part. The real issue is latency and unreliability. When you're making a multiplayer game, you should make latency and unreliability part of your game from the beginning, or you'll have a lot of headaches. In this video, I'll show you how. I'm using the open source game engine Godot, but the technique is going to be the same for Unity and any other engine. I have the basic scene set up already. It's just a spatial node with two mesh instances. One of the mesh instances, the green one, is going to act as the server, and the blue one is going to be the client. We are going to create two scripts, one that acts as the server and directly controls this green X, then it's going to send a message to the client, which is going to control the blue X according to the message. We're also going to have a third script that is going to be a singleton, which will act as our networking. So first we'll attach a script to the server X. Every physics frame we're going to set the position of the X. The server is going to control the X over time, so we'll create a variable with the current time, or rather the time since the game started. This is in milliseconds, so we'll divide it by 1000 in order to get it as seconds. We're going to be controlling the position, so we'll have a position variable, which is going to be a vector 3. Sin time and cos time is what actually creates the circle. And we'll multiply by 5 just to make the circle bigger. Then we'll set the translation of the X to the position. And now we run it. And we can see that the X is moving correctly on the server. Now we're going to create the networking. For this, we're going to use a script that is not attached to any of the nodes. So we create a new script over here. We'll call the script netcode, since that's what it's going to do, and we don't need the ready function. What we're going to create here is a message queue, and that's basically what networking is. It's just a queue where you put things in on one end, and you get things out on the other end. Create a class, we call it message queue. We'll have an actual queue, which is simply an array. And we'll have a function send. Send takes a message, and it simply adds it to the queue. We'll use pushback. And we'll have another function that we call receive. This function just checks if the queue is empty, because then we'll return null. Otherwise, we'll pop from the front and return that result. And so this is basically what networking is. And so we'll create one of these queues that we'll call toClient. And in this example, we're simply going to implement unidirectional communication. That is, the server is going to communicate to the client, but the client is never going to respond. In order to emulate full networking, you'll simply create another queue. Now we're going to make this networking code available to all of the scripts in our game. So we go to Project, Project Settings, and to the Autoload tab. And here we select our networking code and we add it. And so we can see that singleton enabled is checked. And that is going to make it show up everywhere as netcode. So we can close that. So now we can go back into the server and we can add the networking functionality. And that's very simple. We simply say netcode, which shows up there, to client message queue, send, and in this case the message is simply going to be the position, because that's all we're going to need in our example. This is where you construct a more complicated message, but in our example we're simply going to send the position. Now we'll go back to our scene and to the client, and we'll create the client script. Now for every physics frame, the client is going to retrieve the position from the message queue. That is, it's going to listen for messages. So we'll go into network code and to client queue, and we'll receive a message. And then if the position is null, that means there wasn't actually a message, we'll just return. Otherwise, we'll set the position to the translation. And now when we run the game, we can see that both of the X's are actually exactly on top of each other. And so we can see that the synchronization works perfectly. And this is the issue, because that's not how it's going to work in real life. And that's why we need to extend the functionality of this messaging queue to simulate the real world. Now the first thing we're going to change is how often we send messages. So right now the server is sending a message every physics frame, which is about 50 frames per second. Now there are some games that do send position and other information that often, but most of the time that's not what we want, because it's going to get very expensive as we add more and more things into the game. And so we're going to limit the networking frames per second. So we'll create a variable here. We'll set it to 10, and that might be a bit low. It's better to start with 10 frames per second and then increase it if it turns out that your game really needs it. We also create a timer variable, which we'll use to count the time until the next frame. So we go down to where we sent the message, and what we're going to do is we're going to add the delta, the time that has passed, to the timer variable. And then we'll say if the time that has passed is less than 1 divided by the frames per second, 1 divided by the frames per second gives us the time for one frame. So that will be 100 milliseconds in this case. If not enough time has passed, that means we shouldn't send a message yet, and so we'll return. But if enough time has passed, then we'll first subtract the time for one frame from this variable. And that ensures that we'll wait another 100 milliseconds before we'll send another frame. And this will work even if the delta doesn't match with the time for one frame. And so we can see that the client is only receiving a position 10 times a second now. We can lower the frame rate even further to make it even more obvious. Let's go with 1 instead. And so now we can clearly see. Let's get it back up to 10. And now this, both the server and client code is completely finished. All we need to do now is change the networking to simulate real-world conditions. So we'll go to the networking code. We'll duplicate this class and we'll call the previous one instant message queue, because messages instantly arrives. And so we can keep that for later if we like to. So now we're going to add delay to our message queue. What we're going to do is that when we send a message, we're going to determine at which time in the future the message will actually arrive. And so we'll start with the current time, or actually the time since the game started, and we'll turn it into seconds. We'll also create a latency variable, which will determine how much latency we have. So let's say 100 milliseconds. And we'll create a second time variable that describes when the message will actually arrive. So that will be t time plus latency. Now, when we put the message into the queue, we'll instead put this array with just two items, where the first one is the time at which it arrives, and then the second item is the actual message. And then we go down to the receive function, and if there is something in the queue, first have to determine if enough time has passed for the message to actually have arrived. And so again, get to current time. And so we'll check if time is less than the delivery time, that means the message has not arrived yet, so we'll return null. Otherwise, the message has arrived, but we'll need to pick the second element, the number one element, because that's where the actual message is. And so now we can see that the client X is now a little bit behind of the server X. If we increase the latency, we can see it even clearer. Now, of course, latency isn't always exactly the same, and so we'll add a bit of variability by having a minimum latency and a maximum latency. And so now we'll say that the latency is the current time plus the minimum latency and a random chance for more latency. This is going to give us the current time plus some random latency between the minimum latency and the maximum latency. We also want to make sure that our random values are actually different each time. We can do that simply with the randomize function. If we don't call this function, that means the random sequence is going to be exactly the same every time we start the game, and we don't want that. And now we can run the game, and we can see that the latency is slightly different every time. Sometimes it jumps ahead quicker, and sometimes it takes longer. This message queue basically simulates a TCP connection. In a TCP connection, all of the data arrives, it is reliable, and it always arrives in the same order. And the only issue is the variable latency. Now, of course, we don't actually simulate a stream of bytes, but most of the time when we're making games, even if we're using a TCP connection, we're still sending individual messages. And so this class can be used to simulate a TCP connection that is message-based. So we're going to make a copy of this, and we're going to call it TCP message queue. And then we'll continue with this message queue. We'll call it a UDP message queue. That's what we use most in games. And now we'll get to the real fun part, because it's a lot faster, but it also has some issues, and we'll need to simulate those issues. Because we've been adding messages to the end of a queue and popping them from the beginning, all the messages have arrived in order, despite having latencies that are not in order. And that is exactly how TCP works, because it waits for the packets that are out of order to arrive before continuing. And that is one of the reasons why TCP is slow. We'll need to make a small change to our queue in order to have packages arrive in the actual order that they are supposed to arrive due to their latency. We can do this by simply ordering the queue according to the arrival time. We'll do this with custom sort function. We'll call the function sortie, and it will be part of the same class. The way that a sorting function works is that it compares two things to say which one should come first. Some sorting algorithm does all of the heavy lifting. So all we need to do is return true or false based on which of these two comes first. And so we'll check the zero item, the first item, because that is going to be the time. And this is all we need to do to ensure that the first message is going to be the one with the lowest arrival time. Now we can see that the client X sometimes jumps backward in time when a message that was sent earlier actually arrives later. We can increase the latency variability to make this issue more pronounced. Another issue we might have is that a packet we sent may not actually arrive at all. TCP solves this by eventually realizing that the package has not arrived and sending it again, and the receiving side will simply wait until the packet actually gets delivered. And this is the other reason why TCP becomes very slow, because a single dropped packet is going to cause everything to wait for that packet to be discovered as missing and then resent. We can implement this very easily by having a variable for the drop rate, and then saying if a random value is less than the drop rate, then we'll simply return. Now we have a chance of simply not adding the message to the queue. This drop rate is too small to actually see the effect, so let's use a really high drop rate. And now we can see that sometimes a bunch of packages gets lost. Finally, there's one more thing that we need to implement, and that is duplication. Sometimes a package can actually arrive twice, and so we'll add a duplication rate, and we'll say if the random value is less than the duplication rate, then do the same thing again and add another message to the queue with its own latency. Technically, there's a chance that a packet might arrive more than twice. And we can actually do that very simply by changing the if to a while, which means that if we duplicate the package, then there is a chance that we'll duplicate it again. This effect is difficult to see, but generally speaking, increases the jitteriness. That is, it makes the client X jump back and forth even more. The full project with all the code is available on my website, link in the description. And now we can actually see the issues that we will have to face when we run the game over the internet for real. And that's a very good thing, because that means that we can start trying to fix these problems. But that's for another video, so like and subscribe for more.